Hello and welcome to the Line Leader section of Process Industry Chronicle magazine. We feel honored to introduce Mr. Darshan Desai, who is General Manager Engineering at C8 Limited, which is a Baroda-based company. And welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, kindly introduce yourself to the readers of Process Industry Chronicle magazine.
Yeah, I am Darshan Desai. Basically, I did my graduation in 1991. Then subsequently, I kept on enhancing my qualification. I did a post-graduation in industrial management. Then I am certified energy manager also in 2006. These are two of my additional qualifications. Yeah.
And sir, what are your current job responsibilities in your current company, sir?
Okay. So when I say general manager engineering is primarily plant maintenance. Where we have to do asset care. Another important aspect when it comes to engineering function is energy. Because if we see any manufacturing industry, one of the major contributors in terms of cost and efficiency is energy. So similar is the case, typically tire industry, we have got almost 35 to 40% total conversion cost contributes to energy cost. So that is another aspect. Third aspect is with our stringent pollution norms, which is keep on enhancing every year over year. Primarily, we have to ensure that equipment is upgraded and maintained to meet those standards. Yeah.
And sir, what are your strengths and weaknesses as a person, sir?
This is always a learning process. So. What happens, we always keep on continuing on your strong points. Being basically mechanical engineer, yeah, that is my strength, mechanical engineering including hydraulics. Also being lots of work I have done in energy field, so energy conservation, energy efficiency is also another strong area, I would say. When we talk about weaknesses, I will not say weakness is not a right word, it is area of improvement. Now, where you know this area every year or every 3 to 5 years technology changes, we have to keep on updating and align with new requirements, new technologies, new innovation. So it may be recent is Industry 4.0 or IoT, or when we talk about now, people talk about automation. People talk about hydromechanics or electro-hydraulics, something like that, where we have to combine streams and going beyond automation or towards automation.
Sir, when I talk about Mr. Darshan Desai as a person, as a human being, what are your strengths and what are your weaknesses as a person, sir, as a human being?
As a human being, I am a simple person. So, in life, I take or I consider 99.9% of the people with whom I talk or I interact, they are genuine. Nobody would like to have any foul play or something else. So, believing on people, trusting on people, maybe I can say as my strength, because that has helped me a lot over a period of time. And second important thing is, yes, always learning. Third thing is, yeah, I am family person. So let it be with parents, elders, or wife, or children. Yeah. So that is my strength as well as weakness.
How do you define leadership? And how do you develop leadership qualities among your team members, sir?
Okay. Yes, leadership is very important. Because when you are leading team, you should be very clear about for what you are working, for the organization you are working, starting from its purpose, starting from this vision. Every organization will have short, medium and long-term growths or long-term plans. So we should understand what is company's vision and how you are aligning or your team is contributing towards that unique purpose or unique vision. So first, leadership, I need to understand, I need to convince myself with the purpose, with the vision. Most important thing is then I need to communicate. Communication is very clear, and once we have clear communication, then we have to align entire team to a single task, single goal. So that is the quality of leadership. And for achieving this, what resources are required? Let it be cost, let it be something else, let it be other resources. As leadership role, we have to ensure that resources are well supported.
Yeah. Sir, do you think, sir, motivation is important? And how do you motivate your team members?
Very, very important. When we talk about motivation, primarily, first we need to understand because every person is coming up with his own aspiration. So we need to understand what is his aspiration, what he is looking for. As a leader, one should know what is his potential, what he can deliver. Because sometimes someone underestimates, or other way, he or she may be overestimating also. So it is more important to understand and align with someone's need, his potential, and what organization is looking for. So once we understand that, then it is very easy for leader to align his role, align his work, which will motivate him. It is morally, once you understand all this stuff, then it is very easy to align. It is very easy to motivate him. And definitely small wins. Primarily, what is more important is if somebody is doing small wins, like small good works, we need to acknowledge him, we need to give full credit. And at the same time, there are always plus and minus, ups and down. During up time, fine. During down time, motivation or leadership role is more important, where we need to support, we need to understand what has gone wrong, why it has gone wrong. If someone knows during my downtime also there is somebody who is backing up me, then definitely he will be inclined to take more risk. He will work with higher motivation, and definitely higher is the risk, higher is the success.
Sir, sir, how can we flourish more and more innovation in Indian industry, sir?
Yes, fortunately we are in the era where technology is changing very fast. Maybe if you see every 2 to 3 years, max 5 years, technology is changing. So if we have to flourish, or if we have to perform, if we have to adopt cutting edge technology, one thing is we need to support. We need to ensure that training, exposure is given. And once resources are well prepared, well trained, innovation will come. That is my simple philosophy.
Sir, actually, we know that you're a busy man, sir, actually, in plant and outside also. So you have a number of tasks to do at home, and definitely at factory, we know what kind of hectic life it is actually at plant. So sometimes you would have faced stress also, sir. So would you mind sharing some of your stress management skills, sir?
Why stress will come? Stress will come from 2-3 simple reasons. One thing is performance pressure. Second thing, stress comes from failure. Third thing, stress can come from work, say stress can come from home also. So if you don't have good work-life balance, then also stress will come. So when we talk about all three items, performance pressure, it is up to individual. It should be taken as pressure or pleasure. So when you are pushed for betterment, if I take this as positive spirit, definitely it will give pleasure. So when somebody is pushing you for higher targets, there are element of risk, element of non-achievement. So two ways. One thing is we'll take very comfortable target, and then we'll be happy about this. May not help on short term, but someone who is taking stretch target, going for ambitious goals, management understands, yeah, he is taking a stretch target. So you will also get lots of support, and at the end of the day, you will get proper rewards also. Because you know he is the person whom we can bet, he can genuinely put all efforts and try to achieve. So stress is primarily how you are looking at things. Similar is the case with failure. Failure is part and parcel of life. When we talk about manufacturing, it is 24/7 continuous running process. So there will be ups and downs. When we talk about leadership, it is more important specifically during downtime or if something goes wrong, how quickly you are recovering or what is your backup plan, plan B. That is more important. So if I can plan properly, if I have got plan B, plan C ready, then in worst condition, immediately you can change over to plan B, minimize losses. If those things happens, I don't think stress is there. Stress happens only when you are not able to foresee any failure. Then if something comes suddenly, then you are not prepared. And then you have all kinds of stress, pressure, tension, whatever you say.
Sir, how do you manage your time, sir? Do you get, do you get enough time for your family and friends? And
Okay. So this is very tricky question, and in fact, everybody faces challenges with no continuous requirement, demand. You have to be continuously on toes. But what is more important is urgent and important. Urgent means more of firefighting. Important is more of visionary, more of looking at long-term and short-term benefits. So definitely at any given point of time, you will have task which calls for more than 24 hours a day. So it is up to an individual, aligning with your managers or supervisors, decide your priority and apply Pareto principle. 30% of efforts can give 70% result. So what is important, that is more important. And definitely keep 30% of time for sometimes no urgency, which is given situation and you have to manage. So more importantly, how you are planning day. So before starting your day, previously, if you are very clear, say 60% of the time or 70% of the time, I am allocating for this priority jobs, and maybe 30%, I don't know, some urgency will come, it is not in our hand, then I think you can manage well.
So basically we are Indian engineers. We are deeply rooted to our soil, our land and our culture. Irrespective of the fact that whether parents are literate or illiterate, their teachings, and we say the parents are our first guru actually, goes deep in our mind actually. So, and that definitely helps us. Whether we are in a high-tech job, we are working in factory or elsewhere, parents' teachings have their importance and it plays their role at critical moment. So in case if you can please share any of your mother's and your father's teaching, which still crops up in your mind when you are actually at plant, trying to solve some of your critical situations, critical situation or critical problems. At that point of time, your mother's teaching or your father's teaching crops up in your mind and gives you enough strength and boosts you. That okay, it's fine, and this is how you actually, then you actually come up with a solution.
Yeah, in fact, before I tell that, I would like to quote from the recently published your magazine itself. I was reading your editorial page, where you are talking about ethics, you are talking about culture, and then professionalism. So there also very rightly and very clearly you have mentioned about our culture, ethics, everything is rooted from our family, from our society. So 70%, 80% of the culture or ethics or value within us, when we talk, it comes from that root. And when you join an industry, you are carrying those values, those ethics, those principles, and you are trying to align with organization need. So this is what exactly even your magazine also speaks, and I am fully full believer of that. So mother and father, when we talk about our values and ethics, it plays very, very important role. So we learn starting looking at mother and then father and then other people in the family and society. So when I talk about mother, yes, simplicity, accepting whatever comes is reality, and then instead of complaining, what best we can do. That is one of the basic value which was embedded from day one in my life, and which I am really proud of. So that is one important thing which I take from my mother. And yeah, my father, he was quite successful in literature. So I can see every day morning 4:30 to 7:30 was his time for doing something creative. And he sets target for himself. So setting up ambitious target, and only setting up is not important. You have to work hard for achieving. Then failure is on God or environment or society. But our efforts should not be even 1% low. So these are two important things I learned from my parents.
Sir, who's your favorite school teacher and why, sir?
My favorite school teacher right from in school, when I talk, I can say couple of or three teachers which still has left lots of impression. One is principal of our school, Rajnikant Jani. He left lots of impression because I had seen that time in 70s and early 80s he was talking about digital. That time in fact TV was also not there, and in school they have created theater, they were showing lots of international. So he has got that vision and he was trying to imbibe. Every Saturday was not teaching, it was only showing some documentary what is happening around world, which was very unique. Then another teacher I can name is Sri Shankar Lal Trivedi, who has developed me going beyond school. So he pushed us for participating many events. Basically I am from Baroda, so Baroda region and up to state region. So he was the person who kept us pushing in participating, and then we could get some benefits out of that. And third teacher I would say is Mr. R.R. Joshi, who was our maths teacher in my 11th and 12th. So, and also when we go to his class, he used to invite maybe two or three times in a month, early morning or late night. He was teaching us about stars and galaxies and so on, which was beyond syllabus. But he was trying to add something additional, which he was feeling, yeah, it is important. And at least you should know basics. So I fondly remember all three of them.
Sir, who's your role model or guru?
Definitely I will take as father. Father is my role model. I explain reason.
Sir, in case if you can share any one incident from your life, which says that it's actually your parents are your God and nobody else is your God.
No, I will not say nobody else is a God. From every person you can learn something. So, and nobody is perfect. This is also another principle. So when we look at person, everybody has got plus and minuses. So try to see only plus side. Try to grab something which is positive, not positive in mind. Why is doing that positive? Look only at positivity. That will help you. That will help you in developing more precisely or more finely. Yeah.
Sir, in case if you can share any one incident from your life which loudly says that there is hope in life. So wait, don't lose. Something positive is going to come up. Any one incident, sir?
It's very touchy and emotional. I don't know, should I say, or it is, should I say personal or professional?
Any,
sir. So I can narrate which has really touched my life. So actually I lost my sister at a very young age. She was in 12th, and she had, like we are talking about COVID, that time there was a disease called falciparum malaria, and she was one of the first victims where medicines were not there. So I relate with my mother when she came to know, like doctor told us we don't have medicine. So me and my father were aware, mother was not aware. And we cannot say also, she will not be there in couple of days. But when she heard, before she fainted, she said, I want to donate her organs. And she fainted for a couple of hours. So that was something still I am not able to believe. What made her to think up to that point? Because if somebody gives no life shocker news, and that time you are thinking, oh, what has happened, nothing like that. She just said before some minutes, after that she was fainted. She said, I want to donate her organs. And she is very simple, not highly educated. So that is something really shook me shook all of us. Like how, and still I don't have answer. But that is something very amazing. So there is always, what is my learning takeaway? There is something within your soul which constantly tells us what is right, what is wrong. Irrespective, what is happening around society. So if you believe your soul, and if your soul is real, you are not, no, all souls are real, there is no artificial soul. But if you don't manipulate it, if you can listen inner voice, you are completely a different person.
Sir, would you like to thank your wife for her support and help?
Very important. Without her, not possible. Because when I talk about manufacturing, and that too in maintenance, so maintenance and breakdowns, generally, though we say 60-70% are planned maintenance, 30-40% still there are sporadic failures which happens. So there are always urgent call. And if you are in maintenance field, that means you are not entitled for any holidays, because every holiday is definitely a plant shutdown. So you have to be 24 hours in the plant just before holiday, ensure that plant is properly shut down. Entire holiday you are in plant, then holiday ends, you have to start up plant, ensure a plant is normal. Next day you are back where festival is over. So if that understanding is not there, then definitely it will be a different story. So she is very important. What is more important is she understands my role. She supports. Before 2001-2002, mobile was not there. So if some major breakdown happens, taxi comes to your house, he knocks the door, night 2 o'clock, aapko kya plant mein jana hai, and then you have to be prepared. So I had never seen any time complaints. She has accepted that as part of life and always supported. So definitely she is wonderful, and she is reason, one of the reason behind my success.
The next question is, how do you spend your holidays, sir?
Oh yeah, so as I say, organization is important. If you have to be alive during your working days, you ensure that you relieve all your stress, regain all our energy in holidays. So holiday is fully meant for family, no other activities. In fact, I start my holiday with 2 hours of cycling in the morning, which I used to do around 30-35 kilometers. That gives lots of fresh energy. And then depends on family, like what they want to plan. I don't have any say there.
Sir, how can we save energy in plants, sir?
I will touch both the subjects, energy and environment together. Because let us connect what was, now lots of discussions are happening on Paris Convention, which has happened in 2015. That is UNFCCC, United Nations for Convention. Basically, it talks about reducing global temperature by 2 degrees comparing pre-industry era. And that is where almost 196 participants in Paris Conclave, they sat together and they have agreed that by end of this century, we will reduce temperature in environment pre-industry era, means we are talking about before 1960s and 70s, at least by 2%. But in Paris Agreement, internal target which was taken is we should work for 1.5 degrees, not 2. But it was declared at 2 degrees. It is very important. As we know, Government of India also, they have taken very serious steps on that. Good to note that now US is also back to Paris Agreement. And the government is very serious. Almost every year, there are changes in environment laws, pollution laws. We also talk about sustainability. Why we talk about sustainability? Primarily, out of 10 global risks, survey says that 4 global risks are related to environmental disturbances, biological war, climate changes, and fourth, I am not remembering. But these are the 4 which is related to energy and environment. So when I talk about environment, it is primarily energy. The CO2 or 6 gases which we emit in the environment are responsible for climate disturbances. So energy is very important. As I said, 35-40% cost, manufacturing cost is also energy. So even if you see, now most of the companies, not mandatorily, but in their annual report, they started declaring ESG, that is Environment Social Governance. People talk about sustainability. And I am sure in next 1 or 2 years, it will be mandatory. For all the organization, they have to declare what are the sustainability measures they are doing. So it is not more than fashion we have to do. If we are talking about our society, sustenance of our society, industry has to play a very, very important role. And with that perspective, every unit saved, let it be electricity or any other form, or thermal energy. In fact, thumb rule is, if I save 1 unit of electricity, I am saving 3 units from generation. So even if I say I am saving only 1 unit of electricity, actually I am saving 300% more. So energy is very important. Now more widely used is gigajoule per ton of energy intensity, what you are using for manufacturing. So I am fortunate with the company where I am working, we have very aggressive target. We got special budgets only for working for energy reduction, and year over year we take target of 5-7% reduction. So you did not have to follow complications for that. Try to use natural resources wherever possible, cut down your thermal fossil fuels, that is how you can save. When we talk about transmission, there are transmission and distribution losses. Yeah, so I was talking about transmission and distribution losses, very, very huge. Very good technologies have come which can reduce transmission losses by 60-80%. Go for that. When we talk about consumption, yes, now fortunately BEE is Bureau of Energy Efficiency. We can see in most of our electronic gadget about 5-star rating. That is primarily a good initiative which was done in 2004. Adopt 5-star rating products, significantly it reduces consumption, eliminate wastages, leakages are killer. If you see in any industry, highest consumption energy with worst efficiency is compressed air. For generating compressed air, if I combine all efficiency, efficiency is only 15%, 16%, not more than that. So compressed air leakages are one of the basic root cause if I have to talk about energy consumption. If I reduce leakages, I can contribute. For that, you need not require to be an engineer. Whatever way you can do, switch off which is not necessary, eliminate wastages and adopt new technologies. Lots of innovations are coming. Like we have changed from our normal bulbs to LED bulbs. Almost more than one third we have saved. So out of these technologies, yeah.
Sir, how do you update your technical knowledge, sir?
Yes, it is important. As I say, technology is changing fast. You don't have choice, in fact. If you are not updating technical, then you will be obsolete in next 2 years. The technology what you know after 3 years, it will not be available. So good part is that now social media is available. Whatever you want, you can get from Google. You did not have to attend classes. Lots of technical journals are there. Lots of web trainings are available. But lots of books are there. Please read to the maximum to your interest. If you read, you will be more wiser. Not necessarily what you are reading, whatever you are reading. When you are reading, you are adopting some new concepts. You are developing your analytical skills. And that will help in every part of your life. So keep on reading, keep on seeing. Even every failure in my life, I take is that learning. What is the learning from this failure? How I will ensure it will not repeat till my lifetime? How I will communicate to others? So keeping your eye, ear open is most important.
Sir, please tell us in detail the history of your factory or plant and the products and services offered by your factory, sir.
Okay, so I am proud employee of RPG Group. So when we talk about RPG Group, it has got multi-business. So I am associated with Seat Tires. So when we talk about Seat Tires, we have got multiple factories. One factory is near Baroda, is Halol. Head office at Mumbai. We have got 4 plants in Maharashtra. One plant just started in Chennai. And we have got plants in Sri Lanka. Also, we do lots of business by supporting outsourcing vendor. They make tires for us under our close quality checkups and follow-ups. So in nutshell, Seat, we are close to 7,500-8,000 crores of turnover annually, and we are growing. So we have very ambitious targets in next 5 years. And within Seat, I am part of Halol near Baroda factory, which is flagship company, and which produces almost we produce passenger car tires, which is in turn of 20,000 tires per day, and truck bus radial tires, which we are ramping up. Just project is over. So currently we are 3,000, and we plan to complete to reach to 4,500 tires per day in next 6 months to come.
Sir, what kind of maintenance is carried out at your plant? Please share your maintenance plan in detail, sir.
Yeah, maintenance is core subject, and now everybody, because equipment asset is costly, so everybody looks for sweating up assets, ensure that you get maximum out of that. So good maintenance is very important. So starting from conventional failure maintenance, now we have moved to very structured, systematic, structured maintenance. I will say, I will not use preventive maintenance. So when we talk about structure maintenance, it is preventive maintenance. We have very well laid down every task, at what frequency, with what resources, when it has to be performed, and we ensure that it is 100% complete. As my company's culture, even at cost of some plant loss, we don't compromise on PM. But at the same time, we learned only time-based replacement or maintenance will not help. Because whenever you dismantle any machine, definitely you are disturbing original settings. So once you fix it up, it will take some time to restore back to its original original performance. So now we are moving to CBM. So without opening any assembly, I should know, is there any abnormality? And if any abnormality is there, then only I should dismantle. So CBM, we have got lots of predictive tools, which talks about vibration analysis, thermography, sound technology, oil analysis, and so on. Beyond that, now when we talk about Industry 4.0, it is giving me a digital look. So I can put sensors around machine, and very quickly and easily on real-time basis, maybe if I want to configure every second, it gives me input. So when I talk about equipment, mechanical components, primarily it is vibration, noise, temperature. So it gives me indication of vibration, noise, temperature. If I am getting data every second, that means I know trend. Is it maintaining same or is it deteriorating? When we talk about electrical, it gives me enough data on what is input current, output current, what is earthing voltage, what is earthing current, what is ambient temperature inside electrical control room, what are the fault codes which is generating. So which otherwise we are not able to get. And when electronic component, if it fails, then only we'll come to know, yes, my earthing was damaged or there was variation in input current. Now all those things I am able to control through IoT, through Industry 4.0. So I know any disturbance in input current or output voltage or anything else, other parameter, temperature, I know there is some abnormality. Before it fails, we get pre-alert and we get correction. So maintenance strategy is now changing from preventive to predictive, and now IoT. In addition to that, now machine learning, like what we see on mobile app also. If I am traveling through same route, like Google will tell, suggest this is your regular route. Okay. So those kind of artificial intelligence. Basis data, and then we give input to machine. It creates alert and tells something is wrong. And some of the things we can auto-correct also. So this is the technology which is being, this is a major shift. Like earlier, there was real need of very experienced person who can understand all these concepts. But now with Industry 4.0, it will be a completely different lever where we can work more efficiently, more effectively, and we can utilize equipment much more than what we used to do.
Sir, because you are an hardcore mechanical engineer and you have a huge experience. So if I would request you to, in case if you can please share some plant maintenance tips, then I'll be thankful to you, sir.
Oh yes, it is very important. I will try to correlate with what I am seeing now. See, job of maintenance engineer is like doctor. Sometimes what happens specifically with young engineers, if they find something wrong, they hesitate to discuss. They hesitate to discuss, there may be multiple ways, like his supervisor or boss will say why he is not knowing, why he is not able to fix the problem. But one thing we need to understand is, any abnormality if I hide, it is not going to correct. It will only have multiple effects. So today only small abnormality is there and it will create major disaster. So first important tip is, before attending any machine, please understand machine very clearly. Second thing is, after attending machine, even if you don't know, but if you know some abnormality is there, don't afraid. Don't come into fear that if I tell management, then how much loss will come. But if you are trying to reduce loss for few hours, tomorrow it may end up in few days, which will be beyond repair. And I had seen in my experience also, because I am also telling, I started my career from young engineer. So if I don't take care of basic things, it may end up in disaster. It may go to multi-million and multi-billion crores also. So one thing is, as an engineer, be very sure, understand equipment, and if you find anything, don't hesitate to speak with concerned persons. Take advice. That is the first and foremost advice I give.
Sir, can you share some repair tips of any of the mechanical equipment to our viewers, sir?
Yes. This is also another thing I am seeing is, I don't know now what is the curriculum in college, but when we are doing in engineering, we used to have 3 semesters of workshops where we are, I am talking about fits and tolerances. So when we assemble 2 components, there is always loose fit, transition fit and tight fit. So we are explained continuously in 3 semesters, we have to create those jobs and assemble in those standards, fits and tolerances. Any looseness in the system will create chattering and will not give life as desired. It will create lots of issues. So very important to have clear understanding of fits and tolerances. There are standards. We see many times, without understanding that basic, people will just assemble. At assembly it will look okay, but within few days it will create disaster. as mechanical engineer, that is first thing. Second thing, most important is lubrication, hydraulics. When we talk about lube, like I can correlate, if I do analogy, it is like your blood. Even small contamination in blood, how it can impact your human life. If something is contaminated, you know every alternate day you have to go to dialysis and so on. Lube is also lubrication, oil is also heart of machine. If lubrication is not okay, because it is reaching to all contacting parts within the machine. If lubrication is contaminated, lubrication is not okay, hydraulics is not okay, you will end up in disaster. I will give one example. Same oil with say viscosity grade of 68 at temperature of 40 degrees, how it is performing, and at temperature of 65 degrees, performance of machine will straight away change. So it is very important to operate equipment, not only quality, at temperature. If you have violation, even operating hydraulics at different temperature, it will have complete different behavior. So though these are the basics, I cannot, if I have to replace oil, I cannot replace oil from X to Y. Or X is available, I will just add something Y, which primarily I had seen many people does that mistake. No, it has got some purpose, it has got some meaning. Please don't compromise on this basic hygiene.
Sir, can you name a few machines which are heart of your factory, sir?
When I talk about typical tire industry, we have got starting now, it is mixing where rubber and chemicals with sulfur, with carbon black, with silica, with natural and butyl rubber, with oil and other chemicals are mixed. So homogeneous mixing, uniform mixing and intense mixing is very important. Then those mixing sheets which comes out from mixing primarily is made for making treads, sidewalls, ply and other component. So other components are made in calendar and extruders. Then heart of the machine is tire building. So tire is round. So all the components I am able to assemble with respect to center is very important because it is round. So if something is slightly off center, means tire centering is gone. It will create alignment issues, it will create vibration issue, it will create performance issue and so on. And that green tire we have to convert into curing, which will be vulcanized, which will come out as final form. So as I said, mixing, component preparation, assembly and vulcanizing. These four are important process.
Sir, how can we ensure safety at plant level, sir?
There are three aspects. When we talk about safety, we should talk about human safety, human health, and machine safety, and environment safety. So when I say safety, I will not talk about human safety. I will talk about environment safety, machine safety as well. Very important. Also another difference is health and safety. I will give an example. If I get fractured, fracture will be repaired and I will be normal person after 2 months. But if I have diabetes, cannot be repaired. You have to be with sugar disease, which will have impact on your kidney, on your liver and many other organs, cannot be controlled. So generally when we say safety, means unsafe, my hand should not get fractured, my leg should not get fractured. Yes, it is important. But more importantly is no health. If working, I am working in an environment which is very dusty, which can create problem in my breathing system, which cannot be recovered. So more importantly, how I am managing pollution within my working environment, factory environment. That is also very important. Good part is that now government has come up with lots of environmental norms. Also now they are taking it to online monitoring, so we did not have to report on monthly basis. we have to put camera, we have to put sensors which will be connected with pollution control board site, so that they are trying to now plug those gaps, which now generally when we talk about effluent treatment plant, I had seen in my early histories, when a pollution board visit is there, we'll start that plant and again it will shut. That is not the case. So when we talk about soil environment, then above soil environment, our own health and safety, it is prime important. And when we talk about 360 degree, when we talk about safety, it is 360 degree guarding. All equipment, which is rotating equipment, it should be covered with 360 degree guarding. So even if somebody wants to commit suicide and go inside machine, if somebody enters, machine will stop automatically and good sensors are available. So engineering controls are more important.
Sir, you purchase the equipments or machines direct from the manufacturers or from the traders, sir?
Being a big organization where we have got 7 plants and overseas plants also, so purchasing from direct manufacturer always gives advantage in terms of cost. So unless big equipment, we don't go to distributors, but specific small requirements, which is plant specific, which is not repeating in nature, or slow moving items, definitely we go for distributor. So it is basically cost benefit analysis.
And what are your purchasing parameters, sir?
Purchasing parameters, to start with, it will not go with commercial. First, it is going with technical specification. What are the minimum requirements? Because if I talk about any product is available with n number of features. So unless we are very clear on what is technical requirement, we should not go. Otherwise, if I give something to purchase and say, if you talk about Sony TV, for an example, if I don't specify I need 55 inch or 29 inch or 120 inch, if I have purchase, I ask purchaser, if I don't specify I need LED or SCD or flint monitor or round monitor, you will purchase what is available cheapest in the market. So more importantly is freeze technical requirement, have discussion with vendors, specifically for high cost items, and then you recommend to purchase. Now out of 10 players available in market, these 3 are shortlisted, please negotiate further. So first is technical and then commercial. That is the philosophy.
Sir, would you like to thank any local machinery or equipment manufacturing company which should have helped you during any of your critical time or critical situation in your factory?
They are our extended partners. So in manufacturing industry, yes, there are urgent requirements, there are repeated requirements. If we don't have support of workshop of our partners or local distributors, it is absolutely not possible. Advantage with local vendor is available things off shelf. If something is required immediately, I will get in 1 minute or 1 hour or maybe couple of hours. And that is the reason we develop long-term partnership. We call it as VMI, Vendor Managed Inventory. So for 100 items, I know known pattern of consumption. I will say, I will purchase this many items worth of say 1 crore over a period of 1 year. So he is assured that this vendor is not, is having tie up with me. I am not going to somebody else. I am not keeping inventory of those items. As in when required, over phone call, there is a commitment, even if I need night 12 o'clock, within 2 hours, he will deliver at my plant step. So if local support is not available, then we will end up in very inefficient way of manufacturing, because everything I have to keep inventory with me. We will not have any such kind of emergency management. So local vendors are very, very important. And they are actually our external or extended partners. Without them, we cannot succeed.
Sir, please name a few manufacturing companies whose machinery or equipment you are using in your plants.
We have got both equipment supplied from overseas and India, because if I talk about tire technology, it is dominant by German technology. So they are always ahead by few years to us. So by the time it reaches to India, it takes time. Last 2-3 years, I am seeing a good change. Like now, companies in India like L&T. Companies in India, I will say, one is L&T, yeah, of course. Then there are local vendors, no? There are many which I can name. Now sometimes they do reverse engineering, or they come out with some new innovative technologies. So we have got very good vendors available in India, specifically which stand up. Now they have got capabilities and infrastructure to develop new machines as per our requirement. So we are also very fortunate and proud that we, within SEAT, we have got machine development center where we ourselves make many machines. When we say I make machines myself, does not mean everything starting from casting and machining I am doing. So there are many other vendors who are making different components. We assemble machines, it integrates and use for our purpose. So that way there is a good change last few years I am seeing.
Sir, kindly name one manufacturing company which you have actually blacklisted. And the reason for asking this question is because there are few manufacturing companies which are actually willful repeated defaulters. They do default in A company, they do willingly go and do the same kind of default in B company, C company, D company, and they never learn from their mistakes actually, because they are doing it willingly. So it's not the mistake that they think that they are doing the mistake. They are doing it only to increase their profit, and this actually causes sometimes in small or medium or even large industrial accidents. So I'm asking this question only so that actually people can be educated about these companies, and they can take enough precautions while dealing with those kind of companies, sir.
First of all, like I was saying during starting, I am firm believer of people. So I don't agree if somebody willing to cheat us, then he will not be in business. He will not be in business for a long time. So any industrialist, any engineer, by that way, they are not coming in business with short-term objective. But where this gap happens, we also had some instances where somebody has suggested some product, we believed him and it failed. So it is not a failure of he or she, himself or herself. Maybe somewhere when I interpret, somewhere we failed in communicating what we want, or other side he or she failed in understanding what we want, and they have given some different product which really did not work. So as a company, what we take care is, whenever we start venture with any new vendor, we do visit him, we see his capabilities, we see where he is doing business with other good companies. So we have got a very good idea about credibility of that vendor, intentions about that vendor, and then we partnership with him. So it is not right to blame anybody. So I have not seen any only vendor is at fault, because he is always at receiving end. We can ship blame to him, but I don't agree.
Sir, your suggestion and your advice to young engineers?
Yeah, if you are coming to manufacturing field, it is very important for you to understand what you are looking for, what is your interest. Suppose your interest is in marketing, and because of XYZ reason you had come to manufacturing, then that is not your cup of tea. So be very clear where you want to develop a career. When you come to manufacturing also, you have got many options, like there is a production engineering, pure maintenance is there, there is project, there is R&D, there is industrial engineering. So which is your good taste, where you can feel that you are good at? So that is most important, which field you are taking. So don't be shy. No, when you are allotted department, you can always go to your supervisor and talk with him. Though you are given me this department, but this is my strong area, so please reconsider or tell me when opportunity comes. I had seen some people have come and we tried to align. But also I had seen some people are very shy, they will not say. But when they are not performing, then after 2, 3, 5 years we'll understand, yeah, this was not a strong area. If he had gone to this area, he would have been better successful person. That is first advice I will give. Second advice I will give is, think simple. When you are fresh, you had come fresh, you are coming with lots of theoretical knowledge. Try to correlate what is happening. This is advice always I give to my young engineer, don't assume. Because many things over a period of time, I am 30 years now, experience in industry. 91 I have completed my BE. So I must have forgotten many basics of engineering, which I did. So I said, I always used to tell them, don't assume what is happening. Correlate, if you find something wrong, please come and tell. Please come and challenge. Because what happens over a period of time, depending on our comfort, we diverted or diluted from our engineering basics, and we are habituated to do one way which is not correct. So always when new person joins, first 2 years are very important. He can give maximum inputs, and that is the reason if somebody says, I am new, I don't know, I don't believe, because you are coming with very good theoretical knowledge which we don't have now. So they should correct us, they should tell us, don't assume. And third thing is, keep things simple. Nothing is complicated. Everything you divide into small, simple ways, you will be able to learn very clearly. If any doubts are there, please ask. Even at this age, if I don't understand, I ask many questions to even fresh engineers. Why it is like this? What your theory says? So if you ask more, you can learn more. So don't leave habit of learning. It is not that you have done engineering, so your learning curve is over. No, actually your learning curve starts now.
Sir, would you like to share anything else with us which will provide guidance, education and motivation to various engineers working in various process industry verticals?
Yeah, one additional thing I would like to add. I had seen people are moving towards white collar job. Yes, now IoT is there, digital is there. We talk about industry 4.0, there are opportunities. But core manufacturing happens on shop floor. So everything cannot be done by sitting as artificial intelligence or something else. Yes. So when we come to manufacturing, still everything cannot be changed to artificial intelligence, white collar. Human intelligence is required, human intervention is required. So there are good, bright chance, but I am seeing a big gap with new generation. They are inclined to manufacturing. That is not the case. If you are really hardcore working professional, or you would like to do something with your hand, please keep these options always open. You have got bright future, you should do, and you can flourish. So don't carry away by only IT related or white collar kind of stuff. And second thing, like I said, keep simple, very primary and core. That will help.
Sir, it was a pleasure talking with you. We know that you're a busy man, but still you gave us ample of time and you actually shared many of the insights of your life with us. We are thankful to you, sir.
My pleasure. In fact, I enjoyed talking to you. We had nice interaction and lots of learning coming to me also. Thank you.